When you're ready, Nasser, please take it away.
Okay, good afternoon, everybody. First of all, I would like to thank Professor Louise and Dr. Khaled Douglas for their great efforts, actually, in organizing these sessions. And also, I would like to ask thank Arwa for inviting me to give this presentation. Louise has already mentioned the title of my presentation, as you have seen this even before. So I will start by introducing the term the Oman Peninsula. To those who don't know the location of Oman or the term that I am going to use in this presentation, which is the Oman Peninsula, actually it refers to the one unique culture that existed in prehistoric times in the area. Now, it includes the political borders of the United Arab Emirates and Oman. Also, let me first of all give you a short introduction about the Bronze Age in the Oman Peninsula. The early Bronze Age in Oman period, in fact, it is considered as one of the most developed prehistoric periods in Oman. During this time, Oman witnessed several cultural and drastic socio-economic changes that contributed to changing the lifestyles of the previous Neolithic societies that existed in the area. The early Bronze Age is characterized by the emergence of two cultures, as you can see here in this table. The Hafit culture, which dates back between around 3500 BC, and the an-Nar culture dated back to between 2500 2000 BC. Of course, there is an argument about this kind of chronology, but at least most scholars agree on this chronology. We have just been talking about this, me and Lewis, actually. As you can see from the table, for the Middle and Late Bronze Age, the division between both of them did not find its way clearly among archaeologists. So as many of those archaeologists attribute this period to the so-called Wadi Souk period between 2000 and 1300 BC. I will start talking or giving a short also introduction about the Hafit period. The first discovery was in 1970-ish. The first evidence of this period was made by the excavation carried out by the Danish expedition in the burial cairns, or a number of burial cairns, in the Jabal Hafit, in the so-called Brahimi Al-Ain area, now between the two borders, as you can see here in the map, Hafit. The Danish expedition also excavated the so-called beehive tombs for the first time in the area of Bat, dating also to the same period. So based on these discoveries, the term Hafit period later on was adopted by archaeologists in one of their meetings in Tubingen in 1980-ish. The chronology of the Hafit period, the Danish expedition who, as I said, first dated the Hafit cairns to the late fourth, early third millennium BC, based on the recovery of Mesopotamian pottery of the so-called Jamdat Nasr or early dynastic one type. The same thing was also for the pottery found within the beehive tombs by the same expedition dated back to the third millennium BC. Excavation later on in the first settlement or the settlement remains by the French in the Hilly 8 settlement also provided evidence dated back to the same length of time, late 4th, 3rd millennium BC, based on C14 analysis and also some artifacts like the pottery. Of course, later on, more cairns and beehive tombs and also settlement remains, although few, but also were excavated and provided more dating and cultural evolution, which has been widely accepted by archaeologists. The type of evidence, I have to say here, the Hafit period is almost exclusively represented by burial cans, burial and beehive tombs. Now, we have a new type of tomb structures as well as a new burial practices that did not exist or not known in the previous periods, like, for example, the Stone Age, where we had tombs of symbol, for example, underground burial chambers. From this period also, we have very few or rare evidence for settlement. Now, research in the Oman Peninsula for more than 60 years now have only provided us evidence for a few occupational sites. I will mention this later on. So now we had been unable to provide actually much information about the socio-economic aspects during this period. So possibly now we are dealing with communities or societies. They were nomadic herders, but at the same time, maybe we are dealing with some semi-settled agriculture communities. The tombs, Hafit tomb is characterized, as I said, by the large number of burial cans and beehive tombs. These are, as you can see from the photographs here, scattered all over the Oman Peninsula from different geographical zones, but mainly on the mountainous areas. They are found on both on high elevations and low elevations, like, for example, the ridges and summits, slopes, and foots of hills, like, for example, also the wadi terraces, and so on. Hafit tombs are always occurred in concentration and rarely can be found in isolation. They consist also of a single, as you can see here, a single burial chamber, either oval or circular. I will start talking about the Hafit period now, also a quick introduction. Material culture or material remains from this period also discovered by the Danish expedition in the 1950s in the island of an-Nar, as you can see it here on the red oval shape in Abu Dhabi. That's why also it's called the an-Nar culture. Later on, other an-Nar sites were also found in different parts of the peninsula. This is a map showing the most important of these sites. Now, the an-Nar period represents a significant change from the Hafit period, the previous one, and marks the establishment of a more complex socio-economic structure, which we couldn't identify in the previous one. Now, the mechanism that drove this transition appear to be have been the critical shift from the nomadic or semi-nomadic settlement activity to the large and dense sedentary settlements. The population of an-Nar practiced the combination of agriculture and pastoral nomadism, hunting, gathering, and also the exploitation of marine resources. During this time, this subsistence economy, which I have just mentioned now, ran parallel to the specialized production activities and also the exchange of various goods, as well, of course, as well as the substantial foreign trade with neighboring regions, for example, the Indus Valley, Mesopotamia, Balochistan, and so on. So trade is evidenced by the discovery of a large number of foreign items found within or during the excavations of these sites. Now, linked to this development in the local economic system, which I have just mentioned now, and the regional exchange network, a remarkable increase in the number in the population size, first of all, as well as the size and number of settlement and tomb sites, which indicates important development of a social complexity. Now, in Oman, the an-Nar period represent the foundation or the establishment of wadi villages which were then regularly abandoned and then resettled over the millennia. This period also is characterized by a large number of, for the first time, we find the large scale production of pottery, local pottery, manufacturing pottery in the area, as well as the use of good quality of local pottery, which might be possibly it is associated with the emergence of Qabar exploitation in Oman. For the an-Nar settlement, the an-Nar settlement are characterized by stone construction, the famous tower buildings, multi-chamber collective burials, which are distributed over a large area of the peninsula. Now, these sites or these settlements are located in varying geographical zones, as I mentioned earlier, across the peninsula. They can be found in the coast, in the interior, in the mountainous areas, on the Al-Hajar Mountains, and so on. So here, this map showing this kind of distribution of the most important sites. The tower buildings, these are what we can call the landmark of the monument during the Oman period. These are most distinctive type of monument during this time. They are generally constructed, as you can see, from solid solid lower basement, and normally or often have well in the center. Their shape varies between circular towers, here are some examples, or square, or sometimes polygonal towers, as the ones in Bat and Kumaira. Circular towers, of course, are the most common. We can say 99% of the towers are circular. These towers are constructed of massive, large blocks of stones, or built of mud brick, like the case in Hili settlement, Hili 8. Or a combination between both stones and mud brick, like the Tel Abra tower. As you can see here, the inner plan or the layout is a symmetrical pattern with rows of small compartments on both sides. The evidence at the moment shows that there are three types of levels of settlement sites. These are multi-tower settlements, single-tower settlement, and settlement without towers. This map shows the multi-tower settlements, example of these in yellow circles. Example of these are those in a Safri site, in Kumaira site, and also in Bat site, as well as Salut site. Of course, also we have Al-Khashba as one of the good examples of multi-tower settlements. This map shows only single-tower settlement examples of these, for example, in Al-Ghoryeen, which we'll be talking about today, and Wadi Ajran, Maysar, and so on. Now, this map shows settlement without towers. These include, for example, the an-Nar island itself, and also Dahwa site, which I'll be talking about also today. The an-Nar tombs, this map shows the distribution of settlement tomb and bomb pit, which I will be talking about. An-Nar tombs have been also reported across a large area of the peninsula, as you can see from the map. These tombs show substantial similarities in terms of construction, grave goods, burial custom, and so on. They are all, in most cases, located in close proximity to settlement, as Al-Ghoryeen and Dahwa sites here. They are circular, multi-chambered collective monuments, as you can see from these two examples. They consist of between 2 to 10 separate chambers and hold the skeletal remains of up to several hundred individuals. They are built of the of well-cut so-called sugar lump used for facing the an-Nar tomb. For the funerary practices, as I said, these are collective burial, multiple successive inhumation. And the tombs themselves used for primary burial inside these tombs. But we have examples for secondary burial inside bits. After the primary burial in the tombs, then they shift them to these bits. Here again, just to show the bone bit examples from all over the area in the green oval shape. One last comment about the tombs, that for the first time in the whole Oman Peninsula, the tombs show evidence for art, animals, human figures in relief, as you can see here, in the different positions also. Grave goods, of course, we have a large number within these tombs, for example, local and imported pottery, stone, jewelry, and so on. Now, I will talk about the, or present the one example of the early Bronze Age site that we excavated and provided important insight into the settlement pattern during this time, especially for the Hafit period and al-Nar. The site of Al-Ghoryeen is located at the Al-Mudabi area in the northern Sharqiya government, as you can see here from this map. It is sitting on the western side of Al-Hajar mountain, around 95 kilometers southwest of the capital city, Muscat. In terms of location, Al-Ghoryeen site is sitting on an important location in the close proximity or vicinity of important early Bronze Age sites within a maximum distance of less than 30 kilometers. For example, to the west, it is located around 16 kilometers from Maysar and 25 kilometers from Lisk and 27 kilometers from Al-Khashba, and to the west, around 27 kilometers from Zkit and also 25 kilometers from Izki. Now, the site or the settlement has a triangular shape with a total size of 23 hectares, sitting on a wadi terrace at the western bank of Wadi Mahram. Now, the settlement, it is located very close to the northwest of the confluence of Wadi Mahram and Wadi Indam, as you can see here in this image. Between Wadi Mahram and Wadi Indam, and between the two villages of Mahalia in the northeast and Al-Ghoryeen in the southwest. So these also important archaeological sites. Mahalia is dated back, of course, to the Iron Age. Now, Al-Ghoryeen was first discovered in 2004 during the survey of Wadi Indam. With the support of Tübingen University, first season of excavation was short season, took place in Al-Ghoryeen in January 2018 by our archaeology department. And then a second season at end of the same year, 2018, in December, also we conducted the second season of excavation. Now, I will present the result of the excavation. This is the first, as you can see, this is the first paper published about the excavation in Rabinat Bibliography, where more details can be found. Now, preliminary analysis of the excavation revealed that the site was occupied during three main periods, as you can see here. The oldest one or the earlier one is the late Hafit, early al-Nar period, represented by cemetery and maybe settlement and maybe cemetery. And then al-Nar period represented by settlement and cemetery, and Iron Age 2 represented by cemetery. Excavation concentrated mainly on the late Hafit and al-Nar periods. The early Bronze Age structures in Al-Ghoryeen composite of either a building extend northeast, southwest, and they are found mostly in the northwestern side of the site. And also burials that extend also northeast, southwest, and they are found in the southeastern corner of the settlement. For the Iron Age, we have burials found in the northeastern part of the site. Now, three types of early Bronze Age structures have been distinguished from the surface. These are structures indicated here by the red triangular, and they are around 27 structures. With a diameter varies between 25 to 35 meter, and these are, the majority of these are located in the central part and the northeastern part. Also, we have structures on flat areas represented, as you can see by the green squares. They are 33 in total, and with a varying size between small and large building, and these are distributed, as you can see, all over the settlement. We have also a round tower represented by the yellow circle. It is around 20 meters in diameter and located in the center of the settlement. Now, three different also types of structures we investigated during the two seasons of excavations. These are the round tower, two hilly buildings, S3 and section or trench one, and 11 buildings on a flat area. Now, the round tower, as I said, it is located almost in the central part of the settlement. And it is, in the central part. And it is constructed on a flat area inside the settlement. This tower, or the tell where this tower is located, it raises up to around 6 meter high from the flat surrounding surface. This is an aerial photograph image for the tower during the excavation. Now, at least eight, after the excavation or from the surface even, at least eight inner division walls were visible from the surface. As you can see here from the plan, they are connected with the outer wall. Running toward the center of the tower here. So now the ends of these walls or division walls from the surface are not clear. Maybe future excavation can reveal that. Here we have excavated a trench 5 by 7 meters in the southwestern side of the tower, as you can see here, in order to date the establishment of the tower with the hope of finding C14 samples for analysis. As you can see here, this is the trench. At least almost 2 meter trench was dug inside the tower and 1 meter outside. The tower, or the outer and inner walls, as you can see of the tower, were also uncovered, but we didn't reach the foundation of the tower, and we didn't find surface floor at the moment, because this is a very short excavation and short small trench. Also, two division walls were partially uncovered. Very few sheds of regular al-Nar or sandy al-Nar were found within this in room one. We call it room one. And around 1.5 deep in the filling, we found C14 samples of wooden charcoal and dated back to around 2480-2344 BC. The outer wall of the tower in the excavated area showed three different faces. The original facade of the tower, as you can see here with the yellow, built from well-cut yellowish stone arranged in regular courses. The second phase is the destruction, called the destruction phase, where the tower was partially destroyed. And then the tower was abandoned for a while, where accumulation of stones there covered the destruction part. The third phase is the rebuilding phase. As you can see, it is with the light blue, where the destructed part was rebuilt by reusing the old stones and also rebuilt in irregular courses. Also, there are three floors have so far been uncovered outside the outer wall of the tower. These are two floors, as you can see here, L12 and L16, which are the latest. And also one floor, L20, laying under the destruction layer, running against the original outer wall. C14 samples were collected from this earlier floor and dated back to around 2462-2287. So now this dating or this sample is very close to the date of the fill layer inside the tower. As I said, dated back to 2480-2344 BC. Now, based on the results of our excavation inside the tower, a preliminary reconstruction can be suggested for the inner side, as you can see here, of the tower. Maybe there are around 20 room or inner division walls along the inner wall of the tower. That was the result of excavation of the tower. And now I will present the result of excavating the two hilly buildings. These are the trench one, bulldozed section, and building S3. Trench one is located to the southwest of the round tower, as you can see here, the left side. It is part of a large round hill adjusting the round tower from the northeast, as you can see it here. The south end of this round hill was bulldozed in order to create a buffer zone to protect the modern cemetery indicated below, as you can see it. And remains of structures were visible on the surface. So we dug a trench 2x5 meter on the southern side of the bulldozed area in order to uncover the stratigraphy of the round hill. And now, after excavation, the lower building, this is the earlier one than the upper one. In trench one, three main occupational phases were exposed. The earliest one is the Hafit. Late Hafit, early Iron Age. Here, a part of the well-built structure, as you can see to the left side, with floors inside and outside the structure were uncovered, but we did not find any pottery related to this phase, which is expected because normally Hafit periods, we don't encounter such type of pottery. Now, to the north of the building, two hearths were found inside the floor, indicated by the yellow oval shape. Two C14 samples from these hearths yielded almost identical date, as you can see here, between 2800 to 2500 or 499. This here, this image shows the stratigraphy of the building. After the Hafit, late Hafit phase, I said earlier that the building was abandoned where a washed layer were encountered. We call it washed layer or neglected phase. And then a second occupation phase was evidenced by the construction of a new building on top of the washed layer dated back to the an-Nar. Then the second phase was followed by another washed layer or neglected phase. Then the last phase of occupation represented by the large building constructed from Wadi stones of the Qabro, dated back to the late an-Nar. S3 represent one of the large mound hills located in the southwest of the round tower. It was chosen for excavation in 2018. Here two photographs, two images, before the excavation and after the excavation. On the top one before excavation, you can see the walls of the building were clear from the surface, and the top surface was full of or covered with small stones. Then we removed all of these stones to uncover the layout of the building, as you see in the image below. This is the general layout of the building, which was exposed, and the total size is almost 600 square meters, which is the largest building. It has a rectangular shape with carefed stones, carefed corners. The building composed of three main parts with division walls in between. The southeastern part, which maybe represent the front side of the building, and the middle part, and also the northwestern part, which is represent the backside of the building. Now, we dug a trench across the center of the southeastern part of the building. The walls of building S3 showed different architectural phases, as you can see from the plan. However, this is the general plan of the building, as you can see, and each part of the building consists of different rooms. In the open courtyard, we call it room 8, around here was uncovered, sitting next to an oval installation, built from thick whitish plaster with a flat stone. Here, this is a close-up of the hearth and also the oval installation. As a result of our excavation at the trench in S3, at least three main architecture phases have been noticed or notified or counted. The aerial phase, where the foundation of the walls go deep, around between 5-6 courses of stones. And then the middle phase, some of its parts or walls built on top of the earlier one. And the later phase, where the walls are not deep close to the surface, the fire base or the hearth and the oval installation belongs to this period. Three C14 samples of charcoal from the three different phases were analyzed. The first C14 is the earliest one, and we got it from the deepest level, so gave us a dating between 2800-2600. So we are talking about late Hafit. The second sample was collected from the middle area and dated back to around 2400-2200 early Oman. And the third sample was collected from the hearth, which belongs to the latest occupational phase, dating back to around 2100-1900 BC, which represent late Oman. Now I will present the result of excavating building on flat areas. Building on flat areas marked normally, as you can see, by one course of stone embedded in the surface. And in 2018, some buildings were investigated by small trenches to test the depth of the culture layers. Building on flat areas, they are distributed, as you can see here, all over the settlement, and we counted at least 36 buildings on this type of from the surface. Now, in most cases, this type of building were cleaned from the surface, as you can see here. They compose either from one room or two rooms or three rooms. Three rooms are the majority. Here, example of the three room in S5 and S7, and example of one room in S9. Now, with regard the dating of the building of flat area, unfortunately, this type of building was very close to the surface. Three buildings produced C14 samples from a primary context. These buildings are S7, where, as you can see here, we found ash powder at the western side of the division wall on top of the surface of room one, and dated back to 3,700, 3,600. Now, although the date is too early, but the context is still within the early Bronze Age. No pottery was found in this building. Also, S9 produced C14 sample from a hearth, small hearth, 70 centimeter in diameter, where we found charcoal and powder of ash. And the date goes back, as you can see, to the late Hafit, 2900-2700. Also, S20, we found charcoal and in the southwestern part of room one, as you can see here. And the date was 2500-2400. So we are talking about the early Al-Nar period. Now, based on C14 analysis, three chronological horizons can be set for the occupation, early Bronze occupation at Al-Ghoryeen: late Hafit, Al-Nar period, early Al-Nar, and late Al-Nar. Now, for the late Hafit, to summarize, there are four different C14s, as you can see here, samples from three different buildings. As I said, Trench 1, S3, and S7, yielded very close date from the late Hafit. Now, we assume that the building in flat area belong to this phase. Now, this in this case, this is this how this would be the plan for the late Hafit settlement at the site. For the early Al-Nar period, there are three also C14 samples from two different buildings, and both yielded very close dating. To this phase belong all the hilly buildings, and they produce a typical Al-Nar domestic pottery. The round tower also was used during this in this phase. At this point, early Bronze Age, early Al-Nar, the size of the settlement shrank, but the size of building has expanded very dramatically. And the building from the earlier phase were demolished. Their stone were extracted and then reused to construct the huge new buildings. For the late Al-Nar period, so far only one sample from one building produces this date, and most of the hilly buildings and the round tower were reused in this phase. This is example of the typical sandy wear, and which was the majority. And the example of the black slipped storage jars from the Indus, which were in small percentage. That was about the Al-Ghoryeen, which represent two different culture, the Hafit and Al-Nar. Now I will talk about the Dahwa settlement, which is represent the Al-Nar period. It is located in the northern part of Oman and administratively in the wilayah of Sahm. Dahwa site is located around 24 kilometers, as you can see here, to the southwest of the coastal city of Sahm, on the eastern foothills of Al-Hajar mountain. Now, intensive survey carried out by the Department of Archaeology at Sultan Qaboos University revealed five Al-Nar sites clustered in an area of less than 1 kilometer along around Wadi system. These sites cover a combined large area of land more than 30 hectares. And this demonstrates, in fact, the extensive use of the this area during the Al-Nar period. The site, as you can see here, concentrated or nucleated at the confluence of two major wadis in the region. Dahwa 1 was excavated between 2000 and 2017, while DH7 excavated between 2018 and 2021. DH5 we excavated only a tomb in 2006. Now, the main focus of the today will be only on DH1 and DH7. For DH1 is the largest of these sites, as you can see, 16 hectares. During the survey, 17 stone buildings have been identified. Of course, no al-Nar, typical al-Nar tower were found. The majority of the building were rectangular, with some R and square shape. During our excavation, first one and second season, we concentrated on the S10 here, the large building. And then as a result of this excavation, we extended the excavation to include other building here, as you can see, S16, S6, S14, and S20. For the time limitation, of course, I will only present two building, S10 and S20. For S10, based on its location and preservation and size, and also the layout from the surface, we choose building S10 for investigation. Now, this building is the major and the largest building at the settlement, at DH1, with a total area of around 228 square meters. And as you can see, composed of six rooms, long corridor, and large open courtyard with entrance at the eastern side. this is the plan of S10. It composed of two parts, the southern part and also the northern part. The southern part is the primary space and is the earliest one also, while the northern part is an open courtyard, which might be added later. Eston was used in three main phases, early, middle, and late phases. In each phase, it was used for different function. For example, the various indoor spaces and installation could be interpreted as kitchen, storeway rooms, and also working rooms. For example, room three, it's considered as processing room. We found here six hearths, two benches, and a cooking pot. Also, this is a close image for the benches and the hearths. We found also a large number of shells. And also, room eight, we consider it as a copper processing or a storage room. This is room eight. In this room, we found a niche, maybe it was for to keep large storage jars. And two indoor storage jars were in situ. We found furnace with copper slag and black slipped in the storage jar with copper powder. We analyzed this powder and we found large quantities of this powder from some furnaces in DH4. And it is normal copper. There are seven induced black slipped jars found in room eight, and most of them are historical. We found large number of shells and date stones and metal object hook, and also incense burner. This is, as you can see, some photographs in situ. Also, we found in total 24 induced storage jars and one cooking pot from building S10. Now, this large number and quality of pottery and other finds point to a wealthy, in fact, a wealthy society with well-established contact with other societies or cultures, especially with those in the Indus Valley. Maybe, as I said earlier, the wealth of which was mainly based on copper industry or copper exploitation. The second building is S20, which was the smallest building in the settlement with around 16.15 square meters. Composed mainly from one room, which is room one, as you can see here, with an entrance from the eastern side. And a second room, room two, was added later. Both rooms are small in size, and we believe, according to some indications, that the function of this building is ritual. Here you have the white arrows shows that the entire building was founded on a white plaster floor that was laid down before constructing the main building. Also, room one had two benches indicated by the yellow arrows here, one on the western side facing the entrance and the one on the northern side. Also, we found two silos, the earlier one in the northeastern corner. This one was replaced later by another one located almost in the center of the room one. Now, a beefed wide platform was made outside room one in a form of a ramp leading up to the room with two wide stone steps leading to the entrance. Room two was later added to the building. Rectangular platform was made facing the entrance at the western end of the room. A second one was a rectangular also platform was built in the center of the room between the entrance and the back platform. And outside room two, a wide beefed also platform was built leading to the entrance. This is the general distribution of the different installation and the building. We found in this building a spouted vessel, as you can see it here, which is dated back to the late. Now, for DH7, this site has a total area 6.4 hectare. And in contrast with the other four settlements, they are built on flat, which were built on flat wadi terrace. DH1 distributed topographically offer three different levels. The upper level, which composite or include just one building, and middle area, which has two buildings, and the lower area, which has the rest of the buildings, around 32 Oman-Nar structures were identified. Here is a general plan of the site. The settlement here seems to be built according to some kind of form of plan. In the lower area, the building had been clustered into two groups, an outer and inner group. Most of the building at the outer skirt are large and arranged in a way forming some kind of circular shape. The inner one composed of small buildings and built around an open circle area. Now, this is a short video for seconds, which let me just share this video with you. I hope it will work. Okay, as I expected, and this happened also to my colleague. It didn't work, but the point here, which I'm trying to say, that the general characteristics of the building or the architecture, the settlement consists of, for example, typical Oman-Nar. We don't have typical Oman-Nar monument towers, for example. All buildings were built separately, and the distance between buildings vary. In some cases, some buildings are close to each other, while others, in some cases, they are isolated so far from the other building. Most of the buildings are rectangular and very few were square. All buildings constructed from stones. So far, we didn't find any remains of mud brick. In general, we categorized the building based on their size into three main groups. Lower building, contain of around seven rooms, this type represented in a small number, and medium-sized building composed of between three to five rooms, and this is the most common, and small-sized building, which composed between one, two rooms, this type represented in a small percentage. Now, based On the building function, we categorize also them into two main types, public and domesticated or domestic. We found four types of building, public buildings. For example, warehouse, we found one of this type in the lower area of the settlement, and a ritual building located in the highest area of the settlement, and administrative building, which is located in the middle area of the settlement. Also, we found a collective tomb with the bone bit. So far, we only found this one typical Oman tomb with a bone bit. But of course, the other sites of Dahwa, there are some Oman. But in Dahwa 7, this is the only one. Now, the result of excavation, in our two season of excavation, we excavated all four types of public buildings, which I have just mentioned now. We chose also one of the domestic building in the center of the Dahwa area for excavation. Because of the time limitation also, I will only present the result of our work in two buildings, the ritual building and the warehouse. The warehouse, which is S42, located on the east side, as you can see here, of the lower part of the settlement. Now, this size, as you can, this building, as you can see from its size, around 190 square meters, it is the largest building within the settlement, and it consists of two parts. The main one, which is the core of the building, and had six rooms. And also the second part, which is a large open courtyard with a small room. The building is well preserved, except in the southeastern part that was suffered from partially heavy disturbance. This part of the settlement was completely removed and reused by the inhabitants of the late Islamic village for copper production, and where a furnace with large size of copper slabs was found. The main part of the building is composed of a central rectangular large room, and it is the largest room in the building, surrounded by other four smaller rectangular rooms with doorways open toward it. The open courtyard is a large one and has this is the courtyard and has an entrance on the eastern side. And also it has a room in the southwestern corner. Different installation inside the courtyard were found during the excavation. These include, for example, two half round platforms and a small round silo, a large rectangular fireplace with two small benches in the corner. Also a half round shape steps leading up to the small room, and another half round step in the front of the entrance, as you can see here, leading up to the main part of the building. In our excavation, we focused on the latest level in this building. As a result, we identified around 32 black slabbed Indus storage jars. More than of these storage jars, around 17, were found in the open courtyard. Of course, beside the black slabbed Indus jar, we also found other types of local medium and small jars. Now, this building yielded the largest amount of pottery in the settlement. So this indicates that one of the building function was being a warehouse. Also, the extensive existing installation, which I have already mentioned inside the courtyard, indicate that it was used for processing purposes too. This is a reconstruction plan of the warehouse with an open courtyard. And another image showing the warehouse from inside of the main part and the open courtyard, and the reconstruction plan also of the warehouse and covering part of the inside. There are seven C14 samples from this building were analyzed. Three were collected from the trench inside the main part of the room five, And also four samples were collected from the open courtyard and its small room. Now, the samples from the trench and those also from the latest floors in the courtyard and its small room, as well as also the filling inside the silo, produced very close dates, dating back to the third quarter of the third millennium BC, of course, with no notable occupational gap. Now, the sample from the fireplace, as you can see here, showed a late date goes back to the fourth quarter of the third millennium, fitting with the end of the al-Nar. Now, as a result of this C14 analysis, we can say that the building was used for almost five centuries without an occupational gap. Now, the closest parallel to this building is building S10, which I've already mentioned earlier in DH1. It is almost identical with regards to the location inside the settlement size, number of rooms, architectural plan with the open courtyard, and also the finds where large number of black slip jars were found. In total, as I said earlier, 24 Indus storage jars were found inside the warehouse of S10, which indicates that it was a warehouse. This is a reconstruction plan of the warehouse of building S10, and you can see the similarities. The second building is the ritual building in BH7. This building is located in the highest area of the site. Here, an aerial photograph showing the building after excavation. The first excavation was in 2018, and then in January 2021, we excavated the entire building and its surrounding was uncovered. Now, the ritual building composed of one room, as you can see here, and more than 10 different installations indicated by different colors here, built outside mainly on the north and backside of the building. The ritual building consists of a small rectangular room and built from stone walls, still standing to around 50 centimeter high. And as I said, it is the smallest building in the settlement. It has a narrow entrance with a width of around 50 centimeter facing east. We uncovered four installations inside the room. This, for example, will preserve its small platform at the backside of the room with direct access to the entrance. The second installation is the half round one built at the south side of the or wall close to the entrance, surrounded with unworked stones. And the third installation found in the northwestern corner of the room may be made of yellowish plaster enclosed by stone, probably was in form of a platform. In the northeastern corner, the fourth installation was found. It is a small and made only of whitish plaster. It is not well preserved, as you can see it here. At the front side of the building, we found a wide platform along the outer east side where the entrance is located. At the end of the first phase, a thick fill layer was placed inside the room. Outside the building, several installations were also found. Their shape is round or half round, except of one rectangular here, you can see it, the yellow square, which looks like a basin. This is a general view to the backside of the ritual building, showing the silo to the right-hand side, and also the other installation or platforms on the left side. The round and the half round installation were aligned to the back side in one direction. This is a half round platform with two steps built against the backside of the wall of the building. And this is a silo. Its floor, as you can see, covered with thick whitish plaster. And this is another round platform. This is the rectangular basin connected, as you can see, with the round platform on the right-hand side. This is the reconstruction image of the ritual building from the front side. And this is another one for the platform and installation outside. Now, although the finds from S1 were very few, they were at least very distinctive. Here is a unique double-spouted vessel, which we found similar one to into S20 and DH1, and it is made of local al-Nar. This is the shape of the boat. And also we found metal spillage from Qabar, found outside also the building near the basin. And we found a rare object. It is a complete and well-preserved symbols. As you can see it here, this is the dimension of the symbols. It weighs 245 gram almost. And XRF analysis showed that the symbols were made of Qabar. The symbols were found inside the fill layer, and it was placed carefully in the ground, presumably as a kind of ritual offering. Then it was covered with the basement floor. Now, comparison to this kind of symbols is rare. The oldest known symbols in the region come date back to the early second millennium BC, and they come from Mohenjo-Daro in the Indus Valley. However, they are representations of symbols found in reliefs and paintings of Mesopotamia and the Iran, dated back to the first millennium BC. Also, there is a reference to symbols also that appears throughout the Bible, but now these symbols are the oldest symbols to be found in the area. Dating the ritual building, no remains of burning or charcoal or fireplace were found during our excavation in 2021. However, we found two samples of charcoal, but they were enough actually to date the building. One was very close to the early floor, back to the third quarter of the third millennium BC. The second one was collected from the fill layer under the basement floor, dated also to the fourth quarter of the third millennium. So both dates fits well with dates from the warehouse, and all cover the second half of the third millennium BC. The closest parallel to the ritual building in DH7 is the building S20, which I've already also mentioned and talked about. And this is the layout and the plan. Quickly, as you can see here, similarities, the location, all are isolated location. In terms of size, both are the smallest building in the building. Similar features and layout, similar finds, including the spouted facade. Now, I come to the conclusion of my presentation about Dahwa. The site of Dahwa provides, in fact, important information about the Oman culture in the whole Oman Peninsula. This is clear through the following buoyants, which you can see here in front of you. First of all, it is the first or early Bronze Age site to be excavated in the whole Batina plain so far. The settlement shows evidence of well-organized society, and we have seen the evidence. It is in some kind pre-planned settlement. Also, we have a very strong evidence for intensive trade and relation and contacts with the Indus Valley, which was for the first time to be found or to be discovered in the whole Batina plain. Also, for the first time in the Oman Peninsula, we have evidence for ritual buildings from this period, and also evidence of unique ritual objects. Now, for the economy of Dahwa, the excavation revealed that the economy was based at least on two main elements, agriculture and industry. For the agricultural economy, there is an availability of water resources. All settlements located on wadi system. The groundwater level is high and the land is fertile. Now, distribution of settlement around the wadis was based on land use. We have found a good number of palm date stones in building S2, confirming that the settlement economy was based on agriculture. Also, the site is located, as I said, 24 kilometers from the coast, which allowed access and contact with the coast and exchange and trade with the local coastal communities, and also receiving items from the neighboring regions, like the Indus Valley, for example. The exchange between Dahwa and the coast, Dahwa date palm and animal meats, and the coast fish and shells. We found large number of different kinds of shells. Most of them are huffing holes, maybe used as beads. The industrial economy in Dahwa, we have evidence for fragments of furnace wall linings, slag crushing mortars, heap of cover slag. Here are examples of the slag crushing mortars and other examples. And we have fragment of furnace wall lining. We have large quantity of kabar, which was produced by the Sultan or the occupant of DH1, at least. And in terms of kabar objects, they were rare at the site of Dahwa excavated site. So the question, where did the kabar go? Maybe it goes, it is exported to the neighboring regions like the Indus Valley. And exchange between the Oman Peninsula, it is well documented, and the Indus region, which was evolved in the second half of the third millennium BC, which was evolved to regular and intensified contacts, indication. This is an indication of rising complex economic and social organization. Now, robust evidence of regional and international trade relations with the asserted, which was asserted or confirmed by ceramic assemblages from DH1 and DH7, large also range of Indo ceramics were found in both sides, like for example, the black slivet jars, very large jars, perforated vessels, tableware, cooking pots, and different type of decorated vessels. Here are examples of the black slivet storage jars. More than 80% of the Indo ceramics that were found in Dahwa belong to this type of jars, from the surface and from also the stratified context. We have other types of Indus jars, like the large fine ware and the large porous ware. And also we have a perforated vessel, Indus miniature fine ware, and also a local cooking pot. Maybe it's Indus imitation of Indus tradition. Now, I come to the Arabic conclusion. My colleagues, Louise and Khaled, asked me to give a conclusion in Arabic, so I will be shifting to talk in Arabic. خلاصة هذا العرض هو طبعا عنوان العرض كان الغوريين والدهوة مواقع من العصر البرونزي المبكر. تحدث عن عصر البرونزي المبكر وتحدث عن فترتين مهمتين هما فترة حفيت وفترة أم النار ضمن العصر البرونزي المبكر. وثم بعد ذلك أعطيت نموذجين من المستوطنات، هي مستوطنة الغوريين فترتي حفيت وأم النار، ومستوطنة الدهوة التي تعود إلى فترة أم النار. نعم. الآن بالنسبة، كنت أتكلم باللغة الإنجليزية. الآن بالنسبة للعصر البرونزي المبكر، كخلاصة أنه تعتبر هذه الفترة، فترة العصر البرونزي المبكر، يعني أحد أكثر فترات ما قبل التاريخ في شبه الجزيرة العمانية تطوراً وازدهاراً، يعني مقارنة ببقية الفترات الزمنية السابقة. السبب في ذلك هو كثرة الإنجازات والابتكارات الثقافية التي ظهرت في هذه الفترة، حيث أن هذه الفترة أساساً يعني شهدت تغيرات اجتماعية واقتصادية كبيرة مع نهاية الألف الرابع قبل الميلاد، وأيضاً ساهمت في تغير أنماط حياة المجتمعات السابقة، وخاصة في فترة العصر الحجري الحديث أو العصر الحجري المتأخر. بشكل عام يعني علماء الآثار يتفقوا على تاريخ فترة العصر البرونزي في عمان إلى الفترة الممتدة ما بين حوالي تقريباً 3400 إلى 1300 قبل الميلاد، وهذه الفترة تتميز بظهور ثقافتين كما ذكرت، هما ثقافة حفيت وسميت بذلك طبعاً كما سأذكر بعد قليل نسبة إلى جبل حفيت وتؤرخ إلى 3500 و2500 قبل الميلاد، وثقافة أم النار إلى حوالي 2500-2000 قبل الميلاد. هذا طبعاً التاريخ أيضاً قابل للزيادة والنقصان. فيما يتعلق بالنسبة لفترة حفيت، فترة حفيت سميت هذه الفترة كما ذكرت قبل قليل نسبة لاكتشافها لأول مرة في جبل حفيت الواقع على الحدود ما بين عمان وما بين دولة الإمارات العربية، وذلك طبعاً عندما تم الكشف لأول مرة عن مدافن ذات يعني طبيعة مختلفة ومميزة عن تلك التي كانت في العصر السابق وفترة العصر الحجر الحديث، واكتشف طبعاً من قبل التنقيبات التي أجرتها البعثة الدنماركية بقيادة كارين فرايزبرغ في السبعينات من القرن العشرين، واكتشفت لأول مرة وبالتالي أطلق عليها يعني فترة حفيت. عثر بعد ذلك طبعاً على عدد كبير آخر من المدافن في أنحاء متفرقة من الجزيرة العمانية وتركز معظمها في المناطق الجبلية والمرتفعات. لكن أيضاً ذكرت معلومة أخرى عن فترة حفيت هي أن هناك نقص في الدليل على المستوطنات السكنية. إلى الآن لدينا عدد قليل فقط من المواقع التي تعود إلى هذه الفترة والتي أعطتنا مؤشرات على وجود بقايا سكنية، مواقع مثل الغوريين، الخشبة، رأس الحد 6، العين 2، وبات وهيلي 8. هذه كلها طبعاً يعني مواقع قدمت لنا مؤشرات تعود إلى فترة حفيت. فيما يتعلق بالنسبة لفترة النار، أيضاً كما تلاحظ من الاسم سميت بذلك نسبة لاكتشافها لأول مرة في جزيرة أم النار في أبو ظبي من قبل أيضاً البعثة الدنماركية في الخمسينات من القرن العشرين. هذه الفترة تعتبر أهم ثقافات العصر البرونزي في شبه الجزيرة العمانية بشكل عام. لماذا؟ لأنها وصلت أو الإنجازات الحضارية والابتكارات الثقافية فيها وصلت فيها درجة عالية جدا من التطور، وتظهر أبرز ملامح هذا التطور في فترة أم النار في مسألة عملية الانتقال أو انتقال الإنسان من حياة التنقل والترحال إلى حياة الاستقرار الدائم. الدليل على ذلك هو أنه وجدت مستوطنات انتشرت، مستوطنات دائمة أو تمت الإقامة فيها بشكل دائم في كل أو في مناطق واسعة من شبه الجزيرة العمانية من رأس الجنز جنوباً إلى سواحل الإمارات شمالاً. تنوعت هذه المستوطنات ما بين مستوطنات تضم مباني ذات بناء برجي واحد أو مباني ذات متعددة المباني البرجية أو مستوطنات غير برجية. لأن تعتبر الأبراج أو المباني البرجية هي أحد أكثر العناصر المعمارية تميزاً في مرحلة العصر البرونزي المبكر في شبه الجزيرة العمانية، وارتبطت بشكل كبير بهذه الفترة. ما هي هذه المباني البرجية؟ هي عبارة عن يعني مباني ضخمة أو كتلة بنائية ضخمة، إما أن تكون دائرية أو مربعة أو مضلعة الشكل، ولكن غالباً ما تأخذ الشكل الدائري. الآن في هذه الفترة أيضاً يعتبر نظام الدفن في هذه الفترة مؤشر واضح على مدى التطور الثقافي أو الحضاري الذي وصلت له المجتمعات في هذه الفترة. لماذا؟ لأنه ظهر نظام جديد مختلف عن النظام الذي كان شائعاً في الفترات السابقة وخصوصاً فترة العصر الحجري المتأخر، حيث كان الدفن في باطن الأرض. الآن أصبحت أو بنيت المدافن على الأرض وبذات أحجام كبيرة وعبارة عن مدافن جماعية ضخمة، وغالباً ما تكون قريبة من المستوطنات أو المناطق السهلية، وكانت تبنى غالباً بشكل دائري يعني وتقسم إلى عدد من الحجرات للدفن كما رأينا أيضاً في بعض الشرائح التي عرضت عليكم، وتضم أيضاً رفات عدد كبير مئات من الأفراد. لأن تحدثت أيضاً وعطيت مثال عن مستوطنة الغوريين التي قام فيها قسم الآثار والذي أنتمي إليه بالتنقيبات فيه. هذه المستوطنة تعود إلى فترة حفيت وأم النار. الآن ملخص لما ذكرت عن هذه المستوطنة، المستوطنة هذه طبعا تقع على بعد حوالي 95 كيلومتر جنوب غرب العاصمة مسقط، وتم العثور عليها في عام 2004 وبدأت أعمال التنقيب في عام 2018. التنقيبات التي أجريناها في 2018 و2019 كشفت لنا عن بقايا مستوطنة مميزة وفريدة تعود إلى فترة أم النار، ولكنها شيدت فوق بقايا مستوطنة أقدم من فترة حفيت المتأخرة. التنقيبات قدمت لنا مرحلتين من الاستيطان الرئيسي مع وجود طبعا فجوة بسيطة فيما بينهما، حيث حدث طبعا نوع من عملية التغير المفاجئ ما بين المرحلة المبكرة وما بين المرحلة اللاحقة من نظام الاستيطان. وطبعا في هذه المرحلة تم بناء أو تم يعني بناء مجموعة من المباني عرضت نماذج عليها. التنقيب تركز في البناء البرجي الحجري وأيضا حوالي تقريبا 10 مباني سكنية، وكان التنقيب إما بشكل دائم أو بشكل كامل عفوا أو بشكل جزئي. التنقيبات طبعا كشفت عن بقايا مستوطنة تعود إلى نهاية فترة حفيت كما ذكرت. تم العثور على بقايا استيطان في طبقات 3 مباني ذكرتها أنا، هي المبنى رقم 3 والخندق رقم 1 في المبنى 71، وكذلك أيضاً المبنى 9، وعثر فيها على طبقات حرق وبقايا فحم. أخذنا منها عينات وحللناها عن طريق كربون 14 وأعطتنا تأريخاً بالمرحلة المتأخرة من فترة حفيت. فيما يتعلق بالنسبة لفترة أم النار، أيضاً التنقيبات في البناء البرجي وكذلك المباني السكنية الأخرى قدمت لنا طبقات استيطانية من هذه الفترة الزمنية. التسلسل الطبقي تضمن فخار من هذه الفترة وتضمن أيضا مواقد، أخذنا منها عينات حللناها عن طريق كربون 14 وأعطتنا تاريخا بفترة أم النار. الآن هذه الفترة هي المرحلة الثانية من استيطان الموقع. المرحلة الأولى هي مرحلة فترة حفيت، هذه المرحلة الثانية يعني شهدت تشييد مباني فوق المباني حفيت السابقة. أيضا أخيرا تحدث عن مستوطنة الدهوة، وذكرت أن هذه المستوطنة أساسا تقع على بعد حوالي 24 كيلومتر جنوب غرب مدينة صحم الساحلية في سهل الباطنة، وشارت نتائج المسح الذي أجريناه في هذا الموقع عن وجود 5 مواقع من فترة أم النار. طبعا أنا عرضتها سابقا في الخرائط وتحدث عن بعض المؤشرات الموجودة فيها، وركز حديثي على دهوة 1 ودهوة 7 حيث قمنا بالتنقيب عن بعض المباني الموجودة في هذين الموقعين. التنقيبات طبعا الأثرية أشارت أن المباني كانت تستخدم لأكثر من وظيفة واحدة، حيث كانت تستخدم بالإضافة إلى السكن كورش تصنيع، نحاس، مباني إدارية، مخازن، مباني شعائرية وطقسية، وكذلك أيضا أشارت اللقاء وتواريخ كربون 14 إلى أن مواقع دهوة تعود إلى فترة أم النار. أخيراً فاينالي أشارت الأدلة إلى أن الاقتصاد بالنسبة للسكان دهوة كان قائم على الزراعة والتعدين وكذلك أيضاً التجارة والمقايضة مع المستوطنات الساحلية. طبعاً الأدلة أيضاً تقدم لنا معلومات مهمة عن ثقافة أم النار في شبه الجزيرة العمانية، وهذا ما هو كان واضح من خلال الأدلة التي عرضناها والتي تشير إلى وجود مجتمع منظم بشكل جيد، ومستوطنة أيضاً تظهر مخطط لها مسبقاً، وكثافة على التواصل التجاري والحضاري بشكل خاص مع بلاد السند، وأيضاً ظهور ولأول مرة مباني ذات طابع طقسي أو شعائري وكذلك أدوات شعائرية. وبذلك طبعاً أكون قد انتهيت من عرضي لهذا اليوم. Thank you.